you so much. Thank you so much for clicking on this video. I really, really appreciate it. And this is my Dendrobium Hibiki, a very, very popular cross, as this CARECOLLAB video proves. Only in 2009 did it come out from Mr. Omura. And here we are in 2020, and it is a very, very popular primary hybrid. And for that reason, my CARECOLLAB today is with Fernanda Nascimento's Orchids and Succulents, Honeybees and Orchids, What's Up Orchids, and Orchids 365. I appreciate everybody that has contacted me and said, yep, I got that one, and here we are. All the links will be in the description below. And I would say that kind of proves just how many people grow this cute, cute little compact growing Dendrobium hybrid. While I'm standing here, I just want to show you, we can touch the matter of pests. I don't know if these little white dots over here are the beginnings of mealybugs, but in case, then they're going to be gone. Because this little orchid is prone, in my environment here in southern Spain, to mealybugs since 2020. I've had this orchid since the early part of 2018, never had a problem with it. But now, in 2020, it was showing mealybugs on some of the new growths. Some of it can be dust, but when I see a pristine white spot, I am not going to assume anything, and it doesn't hurt just to give it a little bit of a once over with a bit of a alcohol and a paintbrush, just to be on the safe side, because you can see how mine is coming back into active growth. I got 1, 2, 3 right up against the pot, 4, 5, and 6 new growths. That does not include the growths that grew last year in the summer, which are already somewhat mature. You can see here, after having matured these growths early in the summer of 20. This, to say it's vigorous, is an understatement. And I'm quite happy to have an orchid like this in my collection, simply because there are other orchids that do give yourself a little bit of a headache every once in a while. This is not one of them. The fact that it's attracting mealybugs, oh well, that's not a headache. That is just something to be mindful of and be on top of. When I got this orchid, I believe there's 2 orchids in here, but I didn't mess around with the roots too much because I just wanted to get it into the pot and get it to grow and adapt and acclimate into Leca and self-watering. So when I got this orchid, it had, you know, the leafless canes you see here, those are all the old ones that I've had since it arrived in my collection. And they have all bloomed. Have they bloomed on all their nodes? I could now get in there very, very close and have a better look-see to confirm or not. But I'm going to wait until the orchid shows me whether it's bloomed out or not. I'm not bothered by these little leafless canes. To be honest, I think that they provide a storage organism for this orchid should anything go wrong, which we of course hope not. So they stay, but I do make sure that I take off old leaves very, very quickly in order to keep the canes as clean as possible. Since I'm seeing that this one has attracted mealybugs, I don't want it taking out any of my growths or my nodes or anything like that. So you see how tough this is. I'll have to go in with a pair of scissors to take that off so that I don't wreck the possible blooming node on this cane. But other than that, what you see, the yellowing leaves, that's normal. These are going to be the canes that are going to bloom this year of 2021. And it has a reoccurring bloom frequency on older canes. So if a cane is not spent, then there will be a node pushing out and there will be blooms as well. I had a fantastic little show last year, psychedelic pink, hot pink blooms with a hot pink center. Such a cute cross. such a cute cross. I do think I need to maybe think about repotting it sometime this year. We'll have to see. But those blooms are such a hot pink that it's hard actually to look at them while they're in the sun. And this is a cross from the Bractiosum and the Laevifolium. And I have to say, when I researched this orchid before buying her, I was not taken in by the blooms of the Bractiosum. I was a little bit of nya on the Laevifolium. I am just glad that this hybrid has taken on the hot pink of the Laevifolium and the bright orange of the Bractiosum, because the Bractiosum is a little bit more of a washed out light pink, but that bright orange lip, that is the charm. And having combined the two, you got the beautiful, beautiful saturated hot pink color of the Laevifolium with that lovely, lovely bright orange, which shouldn't work under normal circumstances as a color combination. But even the fashion industry has taken this color combination on. I believe that somewhere in the color palette, they belong together and it works. I love it, absolutely love it. They're not fragrant. They're not fragrant at all, but they are super long lasting. This orchid in my hot, hot summers, no humidity, they can last 4 months. From the moment one little cluster opens until the last cluster opens, and then beyond that, it's about 4 months. To have her in full bloom with all the clusters open, I have about a window of 3-4 weeks, around about that. And she will start showing her nubbins possibly around April, and then it goes really, really quickly to get the blooms, and then the blooms stay there forever. Now, there is also a thing with this orchid. It is a cakey machine sometimes, and the cakeys will be there where one would expect blooms. So I have had quite a few cakeys from this orchid in the past 3 years that I've owned it, but they have been very, very welcome, and I've propagated each and every one of them. I have not put them back into the same pot because the orchid herself is so vigorous, but I have had several propagated in the past. And as I keep turning her, I keep seeing more little white dots. So I'm not trying to deviate away from the care, but this is part of how I care for her. The minute I see it, I'm all over it. Especially now in winter, where the air is a little bit more cooler and there's a little bit more humidity around than I normally have, I'm just very cautious because she is really, really getting active here. And I want to make sure that these growths have every chance that they have, even though they may not go to full size. You can see that this one growth here, just as an example, was at the beginning of last summer. These smaller growths, more stunted, they developed towards the end of the summer and subsequently matured during the winter, and they're not as big. Now I have these growths coming at the beginning. They are also considered winter growths because they started during the winter. So I'm not going to get full-sized canes. And that is why I am all over her with regards to pests, that I will not have it, that they take them down. And even if this is, for example, dried happy sap, I get some happy sap every once in a while, I don't care if I make a mistake and think that it's a mealybug. Better safe than sorry in my books. So yeah, how do I take care of her apart from looking at her now and making sure I've got all the white dots taken care of? Well, as you can see, she is in Leca and self-watering, and never skipped a beat from the moment I received the orchid and cleaned up all the old media from the nursery pot. I did not wait for roots. I did not wait for new growths. I just took the orchid and plonked her in the pot and kept my fingers crossed. And I think that's a risk one can take with dendrobiums. They somehow bounce back. You might set it back maybe 6 months, 8 months, but you're not going to stall a dendrobium by being radical, especially not a hybrid. With a species, I'd be more careful, but this hybrid, I took no note at all. Straight away, cleaned her up and into the pot, and we never looked back. And she is actually pot bound. She has to come out of this pot this season. It's been 3 years, and I normally like to keep my orchids in a self-watering Leca setup for about 2, because that's the least amount of damage I will do to the roots when I take them out. But because she's been so vigorous, I've just left her in the pot as is. And seeing, however, the new growth here, right at the edge of the pot, yeah, even this one, right at the edge of the pot, even though I have lots of space here, something will need to be done and we will address that in due time. Not right now, but in due time, because it's round about at this height that they will start producing new roots. When you can see the structure of the bulb come and leafing out. Pretty much that's the time when new roots start. Someday soon in the near future, this one will take it out. We'll have a look at the root system and see how it's done in 3 years and give her a bigger pot. So when it comes to this orchid, as you can see, she's either constantly in active growth or she's blooming. I have never stopped fertilizing this orchid. I use 300 parts per million of fertilizer all the time. Every time she absorbs that reservoir. In the winter, I'll reduce it down a little bit to 160 because the days are shorter. The growths aren't growing that fast, but it's never without fertilizer. It's either, this orchid is either growing new growths or blooming. So the summer, when the temperatures get above 15 degrees Celsius, I will up the whole fertilizer concentration to 300 parts per million. But until then, it's 160, but all the time. I do flush through twice. When the reservoir is empty, I take the outer mask as my measure, and I take pure RO water and just flush her through twice. Very, very rarely now does she even get seaweed because there's constantly something going on. With this one, I don't do much on the seaweed front at all. With regards to how much humidity she needs, I can tell you that in summer, I have absolutely next to no humidity. Anything below 30% is the norm. If I have 40, woof, that's a humid day, but it's not. I've never had issues with this orchid wanting more humidity or struggling because of the very hot, dry winds that I have. And I'm really grateful because there's others that are a little bit more sensitive to my environment. This one is not the case. It just goes in the pot, it's grown beautifully, and blooms long-term. Again, no fragrance, but well, with colors like that, no need. I have this orchid in a directly south-facing location in the rack where I consider, what I consider my blooming alley, and it is behind a curtain. So it is getting extremely, extremely high light all year round. Even in winter, it is under full spectrum lights. But in the summer, it will get even redder than this on the leaves. The anthocyanine will be even more pronounced. The only time it has any kind of direct sunshine is early morning because of where it sits on the shelf. But that is really only a couple of hours, and it's not part of what I consider her culture. That just so happens to be her location. The rest of the day, she's behind a white curtain, so her light intensity is very, very high in my climate. Summer and winter, I make no difference on that at all. If you see her in future updates and you see how much redder she's gotten, well, that's the reason. Even in the shade, what I consider shade, she is getting an enormous, incredible amount of light. And right now I have her with the light source coming from here, sort of this direction, even though this growth is going to jut out straight towards the light. I am trying to bend the majority of my growths here towards the light. So I have her sitting in the opposite direction with a light source coming here, hoping to bring her in. Having said that, that's just a habit of mine. That is what I do. But looking at her now, she needs to be repotted. It'll just make my life much easier in the future when I resituate her in the pot, if I can get the canes to grow a little bit more upright in the pot and not out. And that allows me a little bit more space on the shelf as well. So there's a little bit of training going on here just to keep the growth and bring them up a little bit. And you can see the curvature of the other growth from last year. Same thing, there's a slight nod towards that direction with the direction of the leaves. Make sure that these kind of stay in the pot even for future reference. It's a tight squeeze in winter when I have to bring her in, and I don't let her temperature go below 13 degrees Celsius simply because of my setup. The evaporative cooling with the Leca and the self-watering, you know, I do a differential of 3 degrees in the pot as opposed to ambient air. If I put her to 13 degrees, the pot then has 10, and I don't want to go any below that. But she's one of the first orchids that I bring outside. If I can get steady temperatures outdoors by 13 degrees Celsius at night, she's outside. And yeah, I think I covered it all somewhat. And I really look forward to all the other videos. If, for example, you grow this orchid and you've come to this channel for the first time, thank you very, very much for being here. And if you do videos and would like to join in on future updates, then, you know, my email is in the description below. Join in on the Care Collab for any future updates this orchid will have. And I will be definitely, definitely welcoming anybody else on board to this marvelous long list of Fernanda Nacimiento orchids and succulents, honeybees and orchids, what's up orchids, and orchids 365. You're welcome to join us for future updates. This is a popular hybrid. I am sure that many more have this one in their collection. And if you do videos, come on board. Please join us. My email, again, is in the description below. And I'm sorry, I'm still fussing. I really appreciate all the channels very, very much for joining in to do the Care Collab on this gorgeous little orchid. We've got lots and lots of environments in these channels that are linked in the description. Very, very interested to see how everybody is taking care of theirs. And if it's moving, it's not anymore. Yeah, I'm very, very looking forward to seeing everybody else's videos. And if you do not do the self-watering and Leca setup, then there's other environments and they are also growing their hibiki in a different setup. Please feel free. I encourage you to check out the links in the description. Thank you everybody so very, very much for taking the time to watch. Always so appreciated. I say it, I mean it. Have yourselves a wonderful day. Please stay safe and take care. Bye.